Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Baldwin Auditorium on the campus of Duke University for tonight's concert, A Song for Tomorrow, featuring the Duke University Wind Symphony. My name is Satya. I'm a senior in the euphonium section, and I'm also the ensemble social chair. And on behalf of all the other members of the ensemble, we are so glad you could join us tonight. Before we begin, a quick reminder that flash photography, as well as individual audio and video recordings, are not permitted. We would also ask that you please silence your devices and be mindful of their brightness. The Duke University Wind Symphony is led by Dr. Verena Mösenbichler-Bryant and Kristin Arp. Many of the pieces being played tonight were selected by the seniors in the ensemble and include works by Fillmore, Wagner, Giroux, Tekeli, and Bryant. The first piece that you're about to hear tonight was selected by me, and it is the March Rolling Thunder by Fillmore. It features the trombone section in a very fast-paced, energetic, and fun march. So we hope you enjoy. Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Carlos, and I'm a member of the oboe section. The next piece we're going to play is Elsa's Procession to the Cathedral by Richard Wagner. Elsa's Procession is a rich piece of classical music by Wagner, originally featured in his opera Lohengrin from the year of 1850. Wagner was renowned for blending all elements of opera seamlessly, using recurring musical themes and creating emotionally powerful compositions filled with vivid harmonies, and this piece is no exception. It captures a wedding procession where Elsa, Duchess of Brabant, is about to marry her knight in shining armor. It beautifully encapsulates Wagner's ability to combine intense emotions and stories with a very deep and rich harmonic texture. This piece was chosen by another senior, Heather, of the flute section. Heather chose Elsa's Procession of the Cathedral for its personal significance to her. She played it as a senior in high school, so it's kind of a full circle moment for her. Its intense melodies reinforced her passion for music, and it reminded her of why she loves playing and performing music for so much. So we hope to enjoy Elsa's Procession of the Cathedral.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Maxwell Rosselli, and I'm a part of the trombone section. Our next selection tonight is Tight Squeeze by Alex Shapiro. This piece explores new territory as it intertwines elements of jazz, techno, and dance music all into one singular three-minute piece. Wow. This piece also includes an exhilarating electronic track that truly exemplifies the mixing pot of genres within the song. This piece will be conducted by our very own Kristin Arp, who we are lucky to have as our assistant conductor of the Duke Wind Symphony. Enjoy.
Hi, my name is Nina, and I'm a member of the clarinet section. I'm also a senior this year and one of the Viennese Ball co-chairs. So on that note, please join us at the Viennese Ball Saturday, March 2nd from 7 to 11 p.m. in the Freeman Center. Tickets are available from tickets.duke.edu, or you can find more information on our Instagram page. So the next work on the program is called Rest by Frank Ticelli. Ticelli is a renowned composer who was originally commissioned to write this piece for choir in memory of Cole Carson St. Clair, the son of his dear friends. The lyrics were adapted from Pulitzer Prize winner Sarah Teasdale's poem, There Will Be Rest. There will be rest and shore stars shining over the rooftops crowned with snow, a rain of rest, serene forgetting, the music of stillness, holy and low. I will make this world of my devising out of a dream in my lonely mind. I shall find the crystal of peace above me, stars I shall find. The concert band version, Rest, was commissioned by Russell Mickelson in memory of his father. Though Ticelli largely preserved everything from the original, in removing the text, he felt free to enhance certain musical aspects. So as you are listening, pay attention to the sustained climax and how the full ensemble sound makes you feel. I chose Rest for my senior piece because I played it in high school and it never fails to give me goosebumps. More recently, the piece has meant a lot more to me ever since I've also lost a loved one, similar to those who commissioned the choral and concert band versions. The power of music to comfort us and express unspeakable emotions cannot be underestimated. And so, like Ticelli himself says, as the work ends, let the final bar diminish all the way to silence, and if possible, hold that silence for a moment. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ron Backus. I'm a community member in the trombone section and an alum from way back in 1981. Many things are the same from when I played here as an undergrad. Two standout differences from the 1000s. The first thing is this beautifully renovated hall, and the second thing is that you all are looking a lot younger. I asked to introduce this because I'm interested in all things space. I spent much of my career working on the satellite control systems, including both GPS and the Hubble Space Telescope. Hubble's primary mission is imaging faraway stars and galaxies, but it has also provided a lot of planetary insights within our own solar system. So Holst's The Planets is a musical way to continue that voyage of discovery. Now, Holst wrote this suite between 1914 and 1918, which is smack dab on top of World War I, but a more significant influence was a visit he took to Mallorca, Spain in 1913. There he was introduced to astrology, and that became a lifelong interest and passion of his. Now, central to astrological thought is the power of forecasting and fateful determination based on the character and placement of the planets. This is where we get our horoscopes, and it kind of follows the maxim, as above, so below. So with that background is a significant influence on Holst, we'll be doing Mars, the bringer of war, and Jupiter, the bringer of jollity. Now, Mars has been associated with war going back to Roman times. You'll hear strident discord. Mars has very low atmospheric pressure and is subject to powerful, possibly discordant storms. Perhaps you'll hear a prequel to the theme from the Empire Stormtroopers from Star Wars. And we know from interviews that Holst wanted the stupidity of war to stand out. One clever manifestation of this is that Mars is written in 5/4, that is, five beats per measure, making it impossible to march to. We'll also be doing Jupiter, the bringer of jollity. Now, Jupiter is a gas giant planet. It's 11 times the diameter of Earth, 318 times the mass of Earth, and it has 95 moons. Basically, it's really big, has a lot of gravity, and a lot of chaos. Musical notation is done in Italian, and the performance guidance we're given as performers includes molto pesante. That means very heavy and ponderous, which seems gravitationally appropriate. Jupiter is meant to be a big presence, full of life. To me, reminiscent of the Roman god Bacchus. No relation, that one's spelled slightly differently. But one possible audible discovery in here, again dating myself, is a prequel to the original Star Trek TV series. So I've given the ensemble a break. We've touched on history, music notation and meter, mythology, science fiction, TV and movies, astronomy, astrology, and Italian. My job's done here. Please join us as we explore Mars and Jupiter from Holst's The Planets.
Thank you. Thank you. Hi everyone, my name is Katie and I'm a senior member of the Wind Symphony's clarinet section. Our next piece on the program is A Song for Tomorrow. And as you may have noticed, the name of this piece is included in our program title, A Song for Tomorrow, A Song from the Past. This title reflects the Wind Symphony's mission to promote contemporary compositions while celebrating the tradition of wind ensemble music. Kevin Day wrote A Song for Tomorrow in 2019 in memory of his high school friend Jonathan, who passed away the year before. The title of the composition, A Song for Tomorrow, is inspired by a Latin phrase that was printed on Jonathan's funeral program. This phrase read, Cras alias Deis est, which means tomorrow is another day. Day wanted this piece to embody the person Jonathan was, and to do this, he features a chorale that comes back in different forms throughout the piece. Jonathan was also a trumpet player, so Day wrote an offstage trumpet solo to represent him, as well as a trumpet section feature that builds the climax of the piece. At its core, the work explores different conflictions and dissonances before ultimately coming to a peaceful resolution. Here is A Song for Tomorrow.
Hey everyone, I'm Drew. I am a senior in the trumpet section. Our next piece is entitled Italian Rhapsody, and its composer is Julie Giroux. Giroux started composing at age 8, and by 1992 she became the first woman and the youngest composer to win an Emmy Award for Outstanding Individual Achievement in Music Direction. More recently, she was the first female composer inducted into the American Bandmasters Association. In the composer's own words, Italian Rhapsody is one very spicy meatball. The piece is a collection of Italian folk songs, including The Wedding Tarantella and Funiculi Funicula, along with opera excerpts from Puccini, Verdi, and Rossini. The music is dramatic, with sharp contrasts between solos and the wider ensemble, and from one featured song to the next. I picked this work because I played it for all-state band in my high school and had a lot of fun, so it was one of the first ones that came to mind to celebrate my last semester of college. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy Italian Rhapsody.
Thank you all so much for coming today. I also would like to extend the invitation to our March 2nd, that's Saturday in a week, Viennese Ball. It's the 49th Viennese Ball on campus. It has a long tradition, and we hope you join us and dance to some Austrian waltzes and polkas. The next concert coming up is on April 13. It's our history concert, celebrating the history of the Duke Wind Symphony, but also our place on campus. This is one of the centennial events. It'll be a big celebration. And one of the special pieces on the concert is a piece that was rediscovered, written by Mary Lou Williams, who was an iconic figure here on campus. And she wrote the work as she was in her deathbed at the Duke Hospital. Anthony Kelly rediscovered it. She wrote fragments from the Wind Symphony back then. And now Anthony Kelly, my colleague in the music department, is piecing together these elements that he found and will premiere that work here on campus. So I hope you'll join us for that as well. I want to make sure I'm not forgetting anything. I need to invite you to our reception. The reception is after the performance in the music building, so just head next door and downstairs to the fountain area. Last but not least, we have the composer of the next piece here. He's a frequent guest. If you're a regular of the Wind Symphony concerts, you know him already. Please welcome to the stage Stephen Bryant to tell you about his synthetic sunlight.
Thank you so much. Synthetic Sunlight is a very, very new work. This is not the first performance, but this is the first performance I've ever gotten to hear of it. So it's very special, and thank you for that opportunity. It is a feel-good work at bottom. The band is accompanied by electronic sounds, synthesizer sounds, particularly some sounds that evoke my childhood from the 1980s, and thus the title Synthetic Sunlight. But I think you can also take the title to mean something about synthesizing sunlight or creating it, and everything for which sunlight is a metaphor, joy and warmth and hope, and creating that where there is not any occurring naturally. So I really hope you enjoy the work. A special thank you to Rick and especially to Colin for all your help making this seamless, to Kristin for pressing the all-important buttons on the laptop, and to the band and their lovely conductor for bringing this music to life and putting on the program. I hope you all enjoy Synthetic Sunlight. Thank you.